Great to be here with you today. This video should be up on the 23rd of March. Kudos to the one who pointed out that March 23rd could be a very significant date as far as turmoil in the world. I passed that along. I came across that and I said, you know, let me pass that along. I believe there could be some authenticity about that. I feel it. So, yeah. Okay. Big surprise, huh? Not. June 6th, and for me, July 24th is what I'm saying, July 24th of this year. Folks, you know, welcome to the video. Welcome to the video. It's a great day to be here with you. Every day's a great day. I feel great. I feel wonderful. I boycotted the news. I mean, someone said, hey, did you hear about, you know, I said, not really. I haven't, you know, little tidbits filter through here and there, you know. And so, but the viewpoint that I'm getting now, I'll tell you this: the first step towards to wisdom is to realize you don't know anything, That's the first step. It's a profound step, very profound step. And I can tell everyone in this world, you don't know anything about truth. You don't know anything at all. Start there. Start there. I don't know anything. And ultimately, you end up saying, I don't know what I am. I don't know what I am at all. But that's what I am. I'm freedom itself. But we just really start and say, I don't understand or know what's going on in this world at all. So that way, the more you do that, the more humility you have, the more it opens up your mind to actually seeing what's going on. And then you say, oh, okay, well, that's fine. I've dropped my, you know, belief system that I know what's going on, and so that doesn't threaten me or cause me problems. I just say, okay, that's how it is. Okay, great. That's what I'm experiencing now. At some point, it is so different than what everyone expects that trying to explain it just doesn't really make a whole lot of sense. It really doesn't. So it's more important is to stay on the path of humility, okay? And you will get there, and you will see, and you'll say, oh, wow, yeah, I see what you're talking about. But it's wonderful. Flipping the script is wonderful. The script is being flipped for me to an extraordinary extent. Let's put it that way. Which is great. Which means that you can do it too. Because we're just schlepping along here full stop in the wow. Just every day, you know, doing our spiritual practice. And allowing additional clarity to dawn upon us. And when you see it, you just say, wow, so that's it. Wow, then you say, wow, that's completely opposite, or even more than opposite. I mean, it's not even remotely in anybody's radar, of, you know, in the world of what's really going on. It's not even on their radar, not even remotely. It's way off their radar. So what could you say? What could you say? You know, not much really, right? So what do you do? Well, today I Holy Spirit helped me out big time. Now, I've said to people, look, take refuge away from the world. Don't worry about the world. Take a break from the world. Take a vacation from the world. You don't really know what the world is. I'll tell you this for sure. Taking a break from the world is fine. I mean, let's put it this way. We're all making these sin offerings to this empty tomb. This is a poetic way of putting it, but it's pretty right on the money, actually. All these bodies are just sin offerings that spirit is bringing to this empty tomb, hoping that someday the tomb will be filled with the corpse of spirit. The spirit will be dead. Or another way to put it, there's various ways to put it. This is the trouble. You have to be relaxed when you look at this, okay? You can't panic and try to grab a hold of something. You could say, let's just keep it easy. These are all just sin offerings, that's all. sacrificial offerings. We're just making sacrificial offerings, hoping that in doing so, this will show our belief in some other mind, you know, in the empty tomb. Just let it be. These bodies are just sacrificial offerings that we're bringing, laying it as if, just use the term empty tomb, laying it there, and we're devoted, say, we're so devoted to you, mind that seems that, you know, isn't there. The mind isn't there. But we're symbolizing our willingness to die in order to experience you, you know. But the tomb's empty. The tomb's empty. No matter how many offerings we bring, the tomb remains empty. This is what I'm getting at. We're eternal life. We can't die. But we keep bringing these sacrificial offerings to this tomb, hoping that someday we'll be able to die and experience this other mind, which doesn't exist. It doesn't exist. Pretty absurd, huh? Well, it's totally absurd. That's what we're doing, actually. But you cannot grasp this intellectually. Obviously, it doesn't fit. You'll get unbalanced if you try to do it. So I don't want to say too much about it. But intuitively, I see it. I'm aware of it. So it's just like, okay, yeah, I'm okay with that. Seeing that. In fact, it's made me very, very good humor. I laugh about it now. I see sick, deformed sick people, and I laugh. I say, ah, look at that sin offering. Look at that sacrificial offering. And people think you're nuts. You're diabolical. You're laughing at their suffering or something. No, it's like, oh, look at that unique sacrificial offering. You say like, yeah, maybe this, you know, will finally enable us to get in that tomb and really be dead, and then when we're dead, we can experience that other mind. We just, doggone that eternal life, we just can't experience that other mind, you know. We're just stuck in this one mind of glory and bliss and peace, and, you know, just, oh, how horrible. And nobody's forcing us to make any sin offerings, being sacrificial offerings. We're just doing it, you know, because we have this holy cause. You know, we got to experience this other mind. But really, it's just arrogance. We want to be greater than God. So if you see it that way, you just look. You look at these deformed, suffering, sick people. There's this site on Flickr, someone who's really a great photographer. And I was just looking at it. I just came across it. And it's all these sick, suffering people around the world. And it's just like, and I was just laughing. And I said, wow. Look at that. How unique. What a unique sacrificial offering that is. Trying to say, you know, please put me in that tomb. Can't you accept this? You know, like, as if the tomb is going to somehow incarcerate us. You know, we're if we just bring this offering to it, it says, look, I'm almost dead. You see this offering? Aren't I dead yet? You know, can I die now? The tomb remains empty. It's empty. It's an empty tomb. What did they do? Went to look for Jesus. What happened? They rolled the stone away. What did they find? They found an empty tomb. They found an empty tomb. And we're coming up on Easter, which is Good Friday, is it was crucifixion. And then Sunday morning, Easter, is when they rolled the stone away. There was an empty tomb. Very, very, very powerful. Speaks to the truth very powerfully, actually. Our tomb is always empty, actually. Our tomb is always empty. So, what you find out is you begin to get glimpses and be able to see, and then you just don't want to really talk about it. It's so profound. It's immeasurably profound. So words tend to give us some sort of delineation, and it's immeasurably profound. You know, seeing the mind, everything is now. Everything is just now. But that doesn't explain it at all. You can't really explain it. But you can see it. You can see it, definitely. So I'm going through these tremendous awakenings at this point. And it's great. That's great. Love it. You know, it's a little nerve-wracking for sure. Kind of shaking. And wow, this is great. So it's the discipline on the path that enables us. The humility, I don't know anything. I don't know anything. I don't know what's going on. I really don't know. And I'm going to keep trying to allow myself to see what's really taking place. I mean, there's so many sacred cows in this world that prevent so many from even looking. Yes, I might see that the good absurdity is just as absurd as the bad absurdity. Oh, that's a taboo, you know, it's a social taboo. I can't see that. Someone will going to say I'm a bad person. And so it's very, very difficult. But just be humble and say there are no sacred cows. And I'm just going to see how it really is. And you don't have to necessarily, I mean, I've said a lot of stuff already, for sure, and I could say a lot more, but what's the point? You know, what's the point? Because that might cause you like, oh, I'll get in trouble if I'm listening to this or something. I don't want to stress people out. But, you know, guilt, sacrificial atonement, the guilt, we try to get rid of our paranoia through sacrifice. And the guilt about that, and say, okay, I paid the price, and that should purchase me freedom from paranoia, which paranoia is the other side of the coin of absurdity, which is the coin of arrogance. Once arrogance on one side is absurdity, the other side is paranoia. And the arrogance is the sin of trying to be greater than God. In other words, trying to be something other than perfect. God created us perfect. We're looking for another mind. What's the problem with the mind? The mind is seeking another mind. It's seeking another mind. If it just stops seeking, then of course it'll be aware that it is the mind. Is that we don't find the mind, we are the mind. We don't find spirit, we are spirit. We don't find being, we are being. We don't find awareness, we are awareness. And so all this is, it's dawning on me. I'm having these experiences, waking up 4 a.m. and meditating, and then just wow. But that's not what I want to talk about. I'm more thrilled with something else, really. Which I had an opportunity to stop into a place that have an indoor kind of place where you hit golf balls. I didn't even know it was there. It was tucked away in a corner. And I was looking for something in the store. Holy Spirit said, stop here. So I stopped, and then I'm looking around. I said, I can't find anything, Holy Spirit. You must have made a mistake. I said, no, keep looking. So I found this. Oh, I got some mats I can hit off of, and it's free. And there's nobody saying, watching me, or it's just like, wow, I could just sit here and hit some balls, really? And they have some used demo clubs there. So I said, okay, I need to work on my iron game. I've straightened out my driver, let's put it that way. I'm going to just be confident about that. And it's like, okay. But I said, I got a problem with my irons. I don't know if I can hit them or not. I'm not really sure how to hit them. Change it. Everything's always changing, so I don't know what. So I hit a couple of pitching irons, really good, good goodness. Oh, okay, see. All right, let me try to hit an 8-iron. Got an 8-iron demo club. So start hitting those, and good, that's pretty good. I hit a bad one. Oh, okay, wow. Oh, let me fix that. Whoops, I hit another one. Whoops. More bad ones. What is going on here? Okay, let me get time to get serious. And poof, even worse. So I started deteriorating, and my ball striking deteriorated to the point where it was the worst I've ever hit in my life, and it was like someone who just started could hit it better than I like was hitting it. It was just incredible. Completely fell apart. Everything. I couldn't fix it. And I said, okay, this is a crisis. I've got to fix this. This is my opportunity. And somehow, I made an adjustment. I tried to figure out, what am I doing wrong? Okay, how do I fix that? I tried something, and it worked. Right off the bat, it worked. I tried it again, it worked again. Then I went to a pitching wedge, hit a bunch of shots, perfect. 9-iron, perfect. 8-iron, perfect. 7-iron, perfect. 6-iron, perfect. 5-iron, perfect. It's like, whoa, what's going on here? I've never had such a run in my life. So I went from the outhouse to the penthouse. Just boom, like that. That's pretty cool. 40 years of struggling. And suddenly there's a swing that is works. It's repeatable and it just works like a charm. It's pretty amazing. It has to do, I talked about being on the balls of your feet, how important it is to feel like you're on the balls of your feet, toes of your feet. You're really on the ball, they call it, on the ball. And I've been working out, jumping rope. And it has to do with being on the balls of your feet. My heels are actually off the ground and my head is down. I'm actually leaning forward, like I'm almost going to fall over forward. But it keeps me from swaying sideways, and somehow about the swing it counterbalances the whole thing. So I have this really good balance, and I've been working on my balance. I told everyone, work on your balance. Okay, work on your balance. I work on this roller. In fact, I got another roller today, keeping my balance. I'm getting really good at it now, really, really good at it. It's just like easy now for me. So this all has to do with having balance and trusting in your balance and then swinging from that. And I was just in golf nirvana, really. I went from looking like somebody is the first time they ever picked up a golf club to hitting it like a pro in a stretch, for a minute. It was like flicking a switch. If somebody happened to be watching me, they say, "What the heck is going on? I've never seen anything like this." So it was just a simple adjustment. I just tried something I've never tried before. And when I first looked at it, I said, this isn't going to work. And every time I hit it, I said, well, this it won't work this time. And every single time it worked. I didn't hit a bad shot at all. Not one. Not one. I was like, well, how does this work? This is, oh my gosh, where has this been my whole life? So it's as easy as just like that, really. When you're willing to do it, the spiritual path is the same. When you're willing to take a different stance, wow, everything comes up roses. I bought some Belgian chocolate today, distributed, gave some away. Yeah, just hey. But again, follow my advice. Truly, and boycott the news. I've not looked at anything. I don't look at anything. Sports, politics, news, nothing. I don't know what's going on. But some of the big event stuff, people will say, oh, wow. Somehow people are talking about it and you'll hear it over here or something. Some terrible blah, blah, blah. Oh, okay. There you go. All right, that's all I need to know. I don't need to know anything about it. It's the same old that's ever always been going on here. And if you understand why, you don't freak out about it so much. That's why the teachers, they don't, nothing bothers them, Just all the stuff's going on and they're in bliss and this is what we need. We need those who are in bliss right now. I've been saying this for so long, and it's never more so true than now. And going forward, it will be extremely important. And I'm trying to, get pictures of it onto my mind. I just can't seem to do it. I've got so many, and I can't seem to present anything that's going to be helpful. It's really weird. Humility will help, will save you right now. Just say, I don't know what's going on. I really don't know what's going on. I really don't. And all of my viewing politics and the news and everything is not going to help me one iota to know what's really taking place here in this world. We could say it's a dream. Yeah, but why are we dreaming this way? Why are we get sick? Why don't we die? Why is this? Jesus said, I'm not the body. I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created. But why do we have bodies? We're just carrying these bodies to this empty tomb as sacrificial offerings. That's all we're doing. That's all that's really taking place here. This whole world is just a sacrificial offering, hoping this will result in our experiencing another mind. And then we can say, well, we created the new mind. You know, we're a prime creator now. And looking at this way, I suddenly sort of glimpsed I'm not the body at all. And I realized this is a very different stance to take. But from this stance, great clarity, great peace, great right on the mark is coming. And my golf game is not going to be the same, for instance. You know, my find your game. You know, the game here is not going to be the same when you change a stance and it is working. So, you know, I'm not going to get ahead of myself, but this is really a different approach. I never would have thought of trying to do it the way I just my head down, so down far that I'm going to fall over. I'm going to fall over. No. I can't explain how it works, but teachers always said, keep your head down. I didn't understand. You know, keep your head down. It seems that you start tipping over. Well, that's because you don't have the balance. You don't have the balance. So I've been working on my balance now for like 6 months or 7 months, really, really working on it. And I still am. And now I'm working on my upper body strength with the rubber bands, the Pilates, the rubber bands, whatever you want to call them. I don't know what people call them. It's just some fitness thing. And they're kind of hollow tubes made of rubber, you know, they stretch. And I'm working on just, but balance, forward and back balance is like super important. Super important. Okay? And that led me to have enough confidence to try this. Wow. I mean, I just don't know what to say. So, this is all grist for the mill. You're experiencing reflects your state of mind in this world. So, I was having like a meltdown where I just deteriorated into nothing. I can't do anything. I couldn't even get the ball off the ground, to tell you the truth. With an iron, with an 8-iron, I couldn't even get the ball off the ground. Seriously. Off a synthetic mat. That's impossible. And then I got tried so hard, I was just like shanking it to the left, just rolling the ball to the left, and it was just like, but I didn't get embarrassed, because fortunately nobody was watching. But I did get kind of alarmed, like, uh-oh, my life, it doesn't look like it's going to go very good from here on. And then just make an adjustment, and boom! And I walked out of there. I just walked out of there. I was sweating. I hit a lot of balls. I was really just, I'm tired, you know. Wow. I just kind of walked out of there, like just in the wow, just floated out, like, wow. My life just changed. My life just changed. You know, hitting it solid, hitting it straight is a reflection of the mind. Hitting it solid, hitting it straight. Straight talk, you know, real solid straight talk. Solid straight talk. Like Ramana Maharshi giving solid straight talk. Take it to the bank. He knows what he's talking about. He's giving a solid straight talk. It is true. What he's saying is true. Now we can just say, I don't know, I don't know anything. Just sit there silently, sit there quietly in the wow. I don't know anything. I don't know anything. Great practice. I don't know what I am. I don't know what I am at all. I don't know anything. Profoundly helpful practice. Once we remove all the stuff that we think we know, then the slate is clear and then can be written upon it what's really true. You see, but we can't, what's really true won't be written on the slate if we already have it all full of our own ideas, because then it'll just be confusing and conflicting and cause mental chaos. And so drop all, just I have no idea what I really am. I really don't know what I am. I really don't know what's going on. I don't know anything. I really don't know anything at all, actually. And just sit in that, full stop in the wow of that. Now, another practical bit of advice here. Shifting gears, as we often do, which is good to drive in this car, you shift gears. A little heads up on diet. Okay, I was doing the protein smoothies, Odwalla protein smoothies, and doing really good, but I was started experiencing like real tired about 2:30 in the afternoon. And it was pointed out to me, a number of people have mentioned this, and then it was pointed out to me very emphatically, maybe you have problems with high blood sugar. Check the bottles and see how much sugar's in them. I said, no, this is fine. I'm sure it's fine. It's just protein drink. Well, finally, I said, well, let me go look. Wow, what I found was pretty shocking. Like the mango protein smoothie has like 55 grams, I believe, of sugar in it. 55 grams of sugar. The other stuff like 44. Now, it's some have sugar added, some are just the juices, so to speak. They must be very strong juices, really filtered or something. But I was drinking so much of that stuff. That's pretty much my diet. I was getting too much sugar, way too much sugar. So it helped me initially, it's helped me lose a lot of weight and it helped me keep going, but I was starting to develop a sugar, blood sugar problem. So I had to change gears. So I'm just knocking out the sugar out of my diet. It's time to knock sugar out of my diet. Getting real serious about real healthy diet. It's good to feel like you're doing something good for yourself right now on a pragmatic level, right? As we go through this now, it's the tempest is upon us and the psychological turmoil will be upon us. Those the one who pointed out the 23rd of March, I passed that along. They're probably right on the money because if you take, where it starts, international dateline, the March 23rd starts, earlier than in Europe, for sure, and a lot earlier than the United States, and it may have, it was pretty close to being March 23rd, very close, so it was a real strong get there. The turmoil's upon us, as I have been saying, it's in pleading with everybody to prepare, as I have prepared. Do everything you can to prepare ahead of time, because if you wait until the turmoil is upon you, you won't be able to prepare. It's plain and simple. It's obvious. When you get knocked off balance and just being mugged, psychologically mugged, which is what's happening in the world, and you haven't worked out, how are you going to gradually build up your balance when you're being mugged? That's crazy. Obviously, this is a failed strategy. And this is something that Jesus hammers so many times. I call him the hammer. He just really hammers it home. Prepare ahead of time. When you know the troubles are coming, make sure you prepare ahead of time so when the troubles come, you'll already be prepared. This is super, super important. So I've done my best to warn people. I don't know if anybody has taken my advice at all. I sure took my own advice, though. So, here comes the trouble, and my balance is great. My balance is great. It's so good that I can really hit the shots I need to hit, so to speak. My core, the overall core, just everything is strong enough. It's getting stronger. I have the good habits. It's real strong and getting stronger. In all ways, physically and then psychologically, spiritually, all of this. Strong habits are getting stronger. So the turmoil is just something you it's like you're a rock and it can't wash you away. I guess in a river, you're this out, strong rock, huge rock outcropping in a river, and the river starts flooding, but still the rock holds as it can't be swept away. Can't be swept away. However, still, I give advice that if you feel like you're in trouble, do something that's good for yourself, and that'll start building some confidence in you. So I switched the diet. Holy Spirit had me switch it. And I'm not mad at myself. What I did before worked great. It kept me motivated. Now I'm really into it, and so I can go a little further. Working hard on probiotics right now in terms of the food, low sugar content, going to kefir drink, and Greek yogurt, no sugar, just plain Greek yogurt, plain kefir, which is sort of it's got probiotics in it. Drinking kombucha, something like that, right? Is that what you call it? Kombucha. I've never drinking it before. I thought it'd be horrible. I think I might have tried it once or something. I thought it was horrible, but I just got some kombucha. Guava. It's got what, like 12 grams of sugar, 7 or something. It's not much. And the others have even less, like 2. It's very low sugar. It tastes great, and it's got a lot of probiotics in it. So I'm having walnuts with the kefir. I put chocolate powder, Greek yogurt, and kefir blended up. Drink that, and then have walnuts, nuts and walnuts for breakfast. And I had a nice tofu wrap this evening with sour cream. I got some sour cream, also has probiotics in it. So heavy on probiotics for the intestines, the intestinal health. So we have enough intestinal fortitude. It's kind of a corollary to have an intestinal fortitude to get through these times. Make sure your gut and your overall digestive system is really perking along. I got some probiotic tablets. I've never taken those, some gelatin pills, the refrigerated kind. I'm gonna start taking those. I'm taking my vitamins, all sorts of vitamins. I even got some sunglasses to protect my eyes. I put them behind my glasses. Do stuff that makes you feel that you're taking care of yourself as best as possible. Okay, even though you may not have the type of spiritual habits that I've suggested, they're not so good, and you can still do rudimentary stuff. Feel like you're really on the ball in terms of taking care of yourself. No, I mean, maybe later tonight, maybe I'll make a kale smoothie. Why not? Top off my day with a kale smoothie. But I can't use the cranberry juice. It's a problem. It's too much sugar. All that fruit juice I was using and fruit protein drinks, tons of sugar. So much sugar. Too much. I was getting over 100 grams probably easily every day of sugar. So going on a low-fat, pretty low-fat, yeah, I mean, the yogurt's, Greek yogurt's zero fat. Kefir's low fat, I believe. I eat a little bit of sour cream. It's got some fat in it. But a very low fat diet. Very low fat, no sugar. Knock out the sugar, almost no sugar. I'll eat some whole wheat bread and some cheese. And, pecans. I love pecans. Egg. I'll have eggs. Have a little bit. At nighttime, eat carbohydrates. You're supposed to eat protein in the morning before you go to bed. Eat some carbohydrates. So I have macaroni salad. That's a little, I allow myself that. Have some macaroni salad, mac and cheese or something. It helps you sleep, calms you down. Or spinach salad or something. But keep it pretty simple. Make sure. Take care of yourself now. Take care of yourself. Take care of yourself. It's really important. And I'm really going for it. I'm motivated. Like I said, you start drinking kale smoothies, and hey, that's a good thing. And it doesn't bother me anymore. It's like the kombucha. I liked it. I loved it. I thought, wow, I could really go for this stuff. It was on sale. It's not cheap. It's 16 ounces, about $3. But it don't need to drink a lot. It's supposed to be very good for you. I can understand how it could be very good for you, actually. It's just slightly fermented, and just the taste of everything. It says, wow, this is probably really going to help keep yourself strong. So that's something to build on. Something to build on. doing something well, like that golf swing. I feel, I never want to say, you know, anything about golf, so I cross my fingers when I say this. I feel like, you know, I don't want to say it, but there's too many scars from golf. I feel I'll do well, let's put it that way. Oh, what did I say? I feel I'm ready to do well. How about that? Yeah. I feel I'm ready to do well. I'm going to do well. I'm going to do well. It's going to be fun. I'm going to enjoy it. I'm going to enjoy eating really healthy food. It's fun. It's fun. It's just like, I enjoy working out now. It's like, well, you know, how can I build some muscle mass? I mean, I was a blob. Can I build something out of a blob? Yeah, that's fun. Okay, that's fun. So these are just like basic, simple stuff that everybody can do. It's easy stuff, right? But at least you're doing something you feel is helping you in some way. So this is very rudimentary, right? But I want to highlight this because when the times that are coming now are going to drive everybody down almost to the rudimentary level, actually. So, but at the rudimentary level, you can say, yeah, I'm everything's fine here. Then you can start pushing back and regain, you know, your spiritual perspective. And they're trying to knock it out of you. They're trying to land a knockout blow. The world's trying to land a knockout blow. There's a lot of, there may very well be a bank collapse. In the dream I had with this, it's massive bank collapsed. But, and then it may be that there's a world dictatorship to pull it back together, and all these restrictions are put in place on everybody. It's very possible. Something really drastic is going to happen. And it could involve a bank collapse. It has to do with the psychology of paranoia and those who are trying to accumulate all wealth in their hands to control everybody. And there certainly are those people in the world. There's no question. You call them whatever you want to call them. You know, people have called them various terms and names, etc. And they do exist. They do exist. And they are trying to corner the world and all the power in their hands. There's no question about it. This is very true. And they may suddenly strike. And I saw this. I've seen this in my dream. This mountain lion suddenly attacked this child. Just suddenly came out of the forest and just went as fast as possible and just leapt on this child, little child. Didn't attack the mother, attacked the child. Easy prey, right? And I came rushing to the aid and drove off the mountain lion. And then the mountain lion turned into a person. And the person was this real sick, mentally sick person. And then they said, oh, okay, I won't do it anymore. And then they were looking for a gun or something to go after me. You know, I realized, uh-oh, they're really mad at me. The mentality of the world is really sick right now. Really, really sick. Being driven by severe paranoia. So the child in us is about to be severely attacked, in my opinion. And the child knows the truth, so to speak. The inner child. The inner child is the beautiful, is really... It's a spiritual, it's a symbol when you say the inner child. And that's what's about to be attacked very severely in this world. So I went to the defense of this, and I drove off this powerful mountain lion. They have very strong front forelimbs, you know, when they try to swat you. They're very powerful forelimbs. But I just, you know, I just was able to drive it off without any trouble. Man, I believe the child was okay. I was able to get there really quickly. But just being mauled, you know, it was really bad. So when you get the answer, you don't know what to do with it. That's okay. Full stop in the wow is the first thing you do with it. I don't know how to apply, you know, this new golf swing as far as what am I going to do with this? I don't know. I mean, it's like the options are just like proliferating all over the place. Don't think about it at all. I have no idea. I'm not even thinking about it. Full stop in the wow. That's the discipline. Full stop in the wow. It's difficult to not think about it, isn't it? You just think... I'm eating a little dark chocolate, 2 squares of dark chocolate, 70%. Could be 80%, 85%, whatever you want. 70% tastes really good. I added that. I made this really quick shift, in my diet. I just can't keep having these severe fatigue in the afternoon. It's from blood sugar spiking too high. My gosh, a Coca-Cola must have got like 36 grams of sugar or something. These fruit drinks, 55. Can't have that. No, I mean, I think maybe there's more in it. Maybe it might have been 16 ounces or something. But still, yeah, that's just... God, be careful. Everyone I've talked to says, oh, yeah, no, you can't have those. It's no good. My doctor said, no, don't have those. I had no idea. I thought it was like super health food stuff. I said, it can't be bad. It tastes good. It's the fruit. But actually, in some of it was the fruit. I think I did check. It said no added sugar. So I said, okay, it should be fine. But even if there's no added sugar, that much of concentrated sugar from fruit sources it spikes your blood sugar too much. You want complex carbohydrates to break down more slowly. So I've been eating a lot more recently, just trying to get myself going on this new diet, give myself a little break. I was really down. I've gained like about 3 pounds since I pivoted from the diet, because I was just drinking these fruit protein drinks. That's it, pretty much. I mean, really, just a smoothie during the day and almost nothing else. I was losing weight. But still, I gotta be careful, because I can gain weight real fast. I ate half a pizza in 2 days, and it was, you know, comfort food, and sort of helped me make this pivot. I mean, kefir is an acquired taste. It's okay. Is this, you know, it's not the greatest taste in the world. But I throw some chocolate whey powder in there, and it helps a little bit. I'll throw some fruit in there tomorrow. I'll throw some fruit in. And, you know, maybe have an egg and this protein, you know, not low-fat protein. And keep working out, and keep getting stronger. Keep getting the balance better. But it's go time right now. I know that it's go time. As I've been saying, March 23rd, I believe, is the date. It's go time. So our reaction now to the more we realize, this isn't going to end. You know, it's not going to end. The decline of the world is not going to stop. Okay, it's very important to realize this. It's not going to stop. Paranoia is in control of this world. Now, there's a lot of things I could say. I taped today and said a lot of stuff, but it's too inflammatory in terms of people who get upset. I've already said pretty much all of it in previous videos. And right now is the time for everybody to cool down, right? So I'm not going to lay that stuff on you. This is a cool down video. But I've been waking up like 4 a.m. and just contemplating. And it's just like, wow, I did it this morning. It was difficult, but... there is this perspective. There is a perspective shift we can make. And from that is like a dawning of wisdom, intelligence, of dawning of seeing, you might call it. Dawning of seeing, actually. You just see how it really is. That's all. We have mighty, mighty helpers. Rama Maharshi, a mighty helper and a great brother. Just think of this. We're part of his family. Why else would he come here? He's a family member. He's a brother. He's just say, this is my brother. Rama Maharshi's my brother, actually, literally. How cool is that to have a brother like Rama Maharshi? We must be pretty awesome ourselves to have a brother like that, right? Fruit doesn't fall far from the tree. Come on. Jesus, another great brother, right? How cool is it to have a brother like Jesus? He's our brother. Literally, we belong to the exact same family. Jesus is our brother. So rejoice in that. Our sister, Sri Sri Anandamayi. How cool is that to have a sister like that? Yeah. She is so totally otherworldly. It's a little difficult to relate, and she often said, "Leave me out of it." As far as just so completely detached from this world, in terms of. So that's a little tough one. It's hard to relate. It's difficult. Long Jumpa. What a brother we have in Long Jumpa. What an awesome brother. Wow. What a privilege to have a brother like that. So we must be awesome too, have brothers and sisters like this, and they come to this world, they're here in this world walking among us and said, yeah, you're just like me, you're part of my family, absolutely, you are. How cool is that? Are we supposed to hold our heads down like this? No. How can you have your head down when you have a brother like Ram Maharshi? He's my brother. And just think how you feel about your sibling. Just think if you thought one of your siblings was Ram Maharshi, you know, literally in your family. Would you walk around like, oh, woe is me, the world, or would you say, wow, I got the coolest brother, the best brother in the world. I got such a great brother. It's just awesome. It's just, I'm so blessed. So blessed to have a brother like this. My heart is just full of jubilation, you know, and just spiritual grace, and just wonderful to have a brother like this. How can you get down? You have to, everyone understand that Ram Maharshi is our brother. We need to celebrate this, that we have a brother like this, and celebrate strong, and celebrate continuously. This is something that should be vastly celebrated, that our brothers and sisters showed up and reminded us that we are their brothers and sisters. We're part of their family. And they view us as equal to them. This is how they view us. Literally. And how cool is that? How wonderful is that? Are we supposed to be moping about these problems in the world when we have good news like this? The good news completely outweighs the bad. Totally. The good news trumps the bad. Entirely trumps it. This is a ticklish point. I brought the word Trump, and there's a political election going on in the United States, as many know. I've already made my feelings made clear. I'm not political. I'm boycotting politics. It doesn't matter. It adds nothing to wisdom, really, at all. It's better to say I don't know anything, and just celebrate that we have these great brothers and sisters who are come here to remind us of what is knowable. Okay, what is knowable? Trying to find a mind that doesn't exist is not knowable. So we have this inferiority complex. I can't find this other mind. Where is it? Where is it? What's wrong with me? How come I can't find it? Is it up here? Is it down there? And we get this inferiority complex, and they say, look, brother, my brother, my sister, look. You're looking for a mind that doesn't exist. You're still perfect, exactly as God created you. So, love him or hate him, or whatever, Trump, the fact is, he stood up when the times were the most precarious, psychologically precarious, and said, look, you don't have to kowtow to the narrative of this world, the narrative that New World Order is trying to cram down your force feed you. They're force feeding you. Let's keep this in mind. We are being force fed. And he just said, no, I won't be force fed. And it's like, we're all like, what? He says, look, you're trying to ambush me and you know, at these debates, I'm not going. And we're like, what? Everybody goes. You can't say I'm not going. What are you talking about? And like everything he says, you can't say that. And they say, wait a minute, why not? Why can't he just say, look, you know, you hate me. You want to destroy me. You want to make me look like a fool in front of the world. And I'm nobody's fool. I'm not going to play that game. I'm not playing your game. I'm not playing your game. I don't play by your rules. You're not force feeding me. And this is just like a revelation. It's like we don't have to play by their rules. Wow. And again, whatever you think is fine. You love them, hate them, indifferent, whatever, it doesn't matter. But this transcends politics. It is basically somebody stood up in this world and says, look, we don't have to play by your rules. I'm not playing by your rules. You're not force-feeding me at all. And put his neck on the line. Put his life on the line. Put his neck on the line by doing this. Because he's the target of, you know, I'm sure there are billions of people in the world who think that get rid of Trump and the world would be a great place. You know, this would be the best thing possible for the world. A lot. I mean, he, you know, what am I? I'm sitting here in a nice little safe locale here and just jabbering away for those who are blessed enough to be able to hear what's being said and recognizing there's something being said here and it's going to get better and better and better. But it's just a few people, okay? A few of us here. What is that? I think I'm being real courageous. It's been terrifying, really. It's frightening to speak up in this world. But look at my audience. It's just a few wonderful, wonderful brothers and sisters. But Trump is out there in front of the entire world. He's out in front of the entire world. Just saying, I am not playing by your rules. You're not force-feeding me. We don't have to follow you. I'm not following your narrative at all. You talk about guts. So, whatever you want to say, you got to give it to him. The man has guts. The man has courage. Yeah, he's laying it on the line for everybody, saying, you know, you don't have to succumb to the New World Order. You don't have to. And it's just like, wow. And you know, I got it. I got a boost from that. I got a kick, a boost from it. And then I said, thank you very much. And then I boycotted politics. I didn't follow him anymore. It was a couple of weeks and that was it. Because I understood that's what it's really about. It's not about anything else. Because we're going into this horrific time where politics don't matter anymore. They don't matter. They don't matter. It's, do you go allow yourself to be force-fed? Do you allow yourself to be forced into following their narrative, a certain narrative? Do you feel you must follow their rules? Or do you say, no, I don't have to follow your rules. I'll boycott your stupid debate. I don't need your debate. I don't need your debate. I say, I'll boycott your stupid world. I don't need your stupid world. I don't need this stupid ritual of bringing sacrificial offerings to an empty tomb, hoping that'll eventually result in our spiritual death. I don't need that silly stupidity. I don't need it. I'm not going to follow those rules. I'm not following your rules. So I'm speaking to the world, which is more profound. But he's out there sticking his neck out for everybody, putting his life on the line, to say the least. I mean, it's just heroic beyond a description almost. So many people would love to see him in the ground. So many. With very powerful interests. And, you know, I'm sure he's aware of that. And yet he did it anyway. Nah, I don't think I have the courage to do that. I really don't. So, that's quite something. Very much appreciated. Very much appreciated. It doesn't matter what country you're from. It's the principle of the thing. I won't be force-fed. No, I will not be force-fed. I will not play by your rules, the New World Order's rules. I will not play by those rules. I will not let the gangsters, the media gangsters, mug me. I will not allow it. I won't even go walk down that dark alley where I know you're going to mug me. I'm not going down that dark alley. That's what Trump said. I'm not going down that dark alley. That's a profoundly spiritual thing that he's done, actually. He just said no. He said no. And so all of us who also want to say no, we said, hey, if he can say no, I can say no. And again, I'm not saying this. He's not some saint or anything like that. You know, maybe he's a megalomaniac. Maybe he's this. Maybe he's paranoid. Maybe he's this. But one thing is, it is profoundly courageous and very principled. And he just says, "You can't push me around. You cannot push me around. I won't stand for it." So I don't know if he makes it through or not. I prayed for his protection today, for sure. Because this is a brother that has done something that I greatly appreciate. Right at a time when I was very vulnerable, and the world was very vulnerable, and we felt we just were going to go under, out of nowhere he popped up. It's like John the Baptist popping up. It's just like, you know, hey, everybody. Come get your sins washed away. Come get repent. You know, you don't have to submit to this or whatever. You know, it's like, wow. Hey, he's an attention getter, you know? And he basically said what so many people are feeling. But they're too afraid to say it. And he wasn't afraid to say it. So again, you know, I always have great respect for those who show up. When the chips are down, those who show up, how can they not earn your respect? It's a given. I was thinking of a bumper sticker just saying, not I support Trump for president, but just I am Trump. I am Trump. In other words, I also say no to the plans to, you know, pressure me into being enslaved, really. I do. I also say no. I am Trump. Maybe I'll print that bumper sticker up. I am Trump. Not a political statement, you see? Not a political statement. It's a spiritual statement. I can push back, too. I can say no, too. I don't have to play by their rules. I don't have to play by the rules. No, I won't. I'm independently spiritually wealthy. I have spiritual wealth that I can call upon. I can call upon Longchenpa. Let me tell you, folks. A better friend you're not going to find. You're going to find as good of a friend. Yes, you can find. Absolutely, you can. In Jesus, in Ramaharshi, not in my mom, for instance. Yeah. But you're not going to find a better friend than Longchenpa, let me tell you. I've had some experiences. I'm having more experiences now. You talk about someone who has your back. Let's talk about someone who showed up when the chips were down. Certainly Jesus has, because he has returned and as he promised, so. Absolutely, but I want to highlight Longchenpa here because most people don't know about Longchenpa. That's why I'm highlighting it, because most people have no idea that someone like this exists. We all know Jesus and we love Jesus. Most of us do. But Longchenpa, hardly anyone in the world even knows about Longchenpa, actually. I didn't. I'd never heard the name. I knew nothing about Longchenpa. So I made in November 2nd, 2013, I realized that we are now hurtling towards this period, which we're in now, March of 2016. We are irrevocably hurtling toward this, and it's going to be hell. Hellish-like. It could be, it can be, if we're not prepared. If we're not prepared, I said, well, I just don't feel I'm prepared. The world is not prepared. And so I just made this huge call to everyone, to everything, to allness. I made this plea to allness. I said, allness, please help us. I don't care how, what form the help comes in. Just help us. We need help, and we need it now. That night, this visitor showed up. Obviously, somebody coming to greet me, and he greeted me. And that visitor turned out to be Longchampa. That's who it was. And he said, you know, he's here. He said, I'm here. You made the call. You know, I answered the call. I understand what's going on. And you wanted someone who would help. I'm here to help, plain and simple. So, again, I am a big, big supporter of those who show up when the chips are down. That's, you know, not just talking the talk, it's walking the walk. That's not something you don't forget that. You don't ever forget that. When you're really, you know who your friends are when you're in a severe crisis and they're the ones that show up and say, I'm here to help you. Those are your real friends. And I'll tell you, everyone, Longchampa is a true friend of all of us. In the highest, best sense of the word. He has our back. He has our spiritual back. And nobody is going to tell him that he has to play by their rules. Okay? He's playing by the rules of truth. He knows the rules. He knows the game. He knows what's going on. This is a brother that is fabulous. How fabulous it is to have a brother like this. It's just beyond words. You can't even describe, you know, just appreciation. Come out of nowhere for me. It's just what a grace, you know, just someone to pop up like this. I said, you know, just wow. With a lifeguard shirt. He's wearing a lifeguard shirt. I'm here to guard life. I won't let you drown. In other words, what does a lifeguard do? They make sure you don't drown, right? He was wearing a lifeguard shirt when he showed up. Basically saying, I'm not going to let you drown. I'm here to make sure that we all don't drown. I'll see to it that we do not drown. You know, this is obviously, he's all dressed for the job, dressed for success there. Completely relaxed, completely poised, not panicked in the slightest bit. You could tell he knew his business. When it comes to being a lifeguard, you could tell here's someone who's an A number one lifeguard. And in getting to know him, you know, it's just becoming more and more evident of his expertise, of his facility, of his capacity. Truly is deserving of all the accolades that Buddhism has given him. They called him the second Buddha. That's how profound the esteem is among some Buddhists towards Longchampa, the second Buddha. That's, you talk about high praise. How can you get higher praise than that? And for someone to just casually show up and answer your prayer like that is just, you know, it's hard to describe, isn't it? So he means business. I mean, he protects the Dharma. He protects spiritual teaching. He's not going to let it drown. He will not let it drown. And it will continue to be more profound and more profound and more gratitude as we see. Just, you know, I'm just gradually, you know, waking up to this is just, wow. You know, this is the big show now, and the heavyweights are showing up. This is for heavyweights. What's going on right now is it's a heavyweight battle right now that's taking place in the world. It really is. Now, I was collecting all these pictures of Longchampa a couple of days ago, and all these mandalas or tankas or however they call it, thangkas or tapestries, and so many. I got so many. I didn't realize there's so many. And in collecting them, I was looking at him, say, which one looks like him? You know, and there's a statue that looks just like him, a couple of them. There is one looks like me statue that he looked at. He said it looks a lot like me, but it's a little too stylized, actually. It may have looked like him in older age or something, but the Longchampa that came to me in the dream, I saw this one depiction of a statue or something, and wow, looked just like him, very much like him, a couple of them. And you look at those tapestries and mandalas of Longchampa, and I was looking at those, and it made a profound impression upon me. You know, the high Tibetan Buddhist tradition, they're just dealing with, they're dealing with stuff that we just are, don't know so much, so well. They have some sort of genius that is really off the charts. I don't try to figure it out. I really don't. I've never really paid much attention to mandalas or anything like that, because I feel like it's out of my league. It's out of my league. There's something about him that is quite profound and spiritual. Vajrayana Buddhism feels that there are ways to sort of induce realization, and these mandalas are one of the ways, actually. And the empowerment that they've done throughout the ages, the empowerments, somehow I got this empowerment from it all. Really, I did. I don't know how. I wasn't trying to at all. But the mind stream of Longchampa, I sort of tapped into it, became aware of it, and saw it, and experienced it. And it's just like, wow, this is legit. Look at this. He knows this. This is what he knows. This is, oh my gosh. So you get all kudos to the Tibetan Buddhist tradition. All kudos, really, really. You talk about massive effort on their part to empower all this and enrich all this. What a stupendous job they have done, really. So much effort they've put into it. Such dedication is you can't measure it. And seeing the mind stream of Longchampa, experiencing it, just made me very humble to realize that you're talking about the experts. I mean, you can see it, you know, but it's hard to explain. You just feel, you know, it's like these are pros. You know, there's a respect there. These are real pros. In the highest way, and you just respect it and appreciate it and have gratitude for it. We appreciate it. And, you know, we still have to just be, you know, be where we're at. That's okay. I'm not going to try and figure out these mandalas or something. But I can say there is some sort of, something positive happens. You know, we try to get an intellect involved that's going to mess things up. And it's interesting. Maybe somebody doesn't understand any of that stuff at all. Maybe their mind is just open. My mind is just not have any concepts about it at all. Maybe that's actually helpful. Maybe that makes it even transmission better than if you're all conceptually engaged in it and practicing this and that. Not just experience. I just looked at him. I felt his mind. You know, I feel like I'm aware of Longchampa's mind looking at this. That's all. And so, also, this is the mind. This is the natural mind. Wow. Love it. I love it. Wow. It's the poise, the clarity, the stillness. But it's just all, but it's natural. It's not contrived. It really is natural. I said, but how can you put this in, explain it? You can't. You have to experience it. So, these Tibetan Buddhists, I can't even put it into words, really. Now, contemporary ones, well, you know, this world, contemporary materialist world, has done a number on everybody, hasn't it? So I can't really speak to those who are contemporary so much. It's hard for me to say one way or the other. I don't even worry about it. I know that Jamyang Yancey Choki Lodro was very much of a heavyweight. He's already done some miracles for me, and I have great respect for him. There's no question about it. This is someone you just know. But we don't have to worry about stuff like that. I mean, the tradition is there. The greatness is there. And they haven't forgot about us. They haven't forgot about us. Not at all. They're bodhisattvas. They have vows. They take their bodhisattva vows very seriously. Really, they do. Yeah, they vow to help us out until all of us realize the truth of our natural being, which is perfection, and without us having to establish it or maintain it or do anything about it whatsoever. You know, they take that seriously. Real serious. It's just like Longchenpa showed up. He said, well, this is what I do. You know? It's like, it's no big deal. That's how ingrained it is in them. This is what I am. I'm a helper. I help. This is what I do. There is nothing like, hey, I'm a hero coming to the rescue. Nothing like that at all. Nothing like that at all. No, it just says you called, you asked for help. Help is, that's what I am. I'm a helper. I'm here to help. Plain and simple. That's no spiritual ego at all. It's just what he is. It's what he is. It enriches him in some way, you know. It gives him. It's how he sees it, that we need help. He loves helping us. It's not a burden upon him, you know. Not asking payment or anything like that. Nothing like that. No. So these are jewels. These are jewels, really. I wasn't aware of just this so much. You know, the West it's been very difficult to appreciate Tibetan Buddhism at the high level that it needs to be appreciated at. Okay, it's been very difficult. I've tried throughout my life. I've been aware that I'm not up to speed on it, but I just said, wow, I just don't get it. I really don't get it. Now I'm starting to get it. And, well, leave it that way. Let's leave it on a very positive note. You know, the world is really hitting us hard right now. So, you know, stumbles happen here. Stumbles are happening now. We're all probably stumbling, aren't we? What we need to do is pick each other up, and pat each other on the back and say, it's okay, it's okay. Work on your balance here. Stay balanced. Come on. We can do better. We can do better. We're going to win. We're going to win this one. Truth wins out, right? Truth trumps lies, absolutely. And it outweighs it for sure. It outweighs nothing, yeah. Feather outweighs nothing, doesn't it? Completely. See, this is the talk about abstraction. Just imagine you're balancing a scale, and on one part of the scale is nothing at all. The other scale, you put a feather. Well, how much does a feather outweigh the other side? Completely. Completely. Put an atom on that scale. How much does that outweigh the other side? Completely. Put a stone on. How much does that weigh? Completely. This is what I'm talking about in abstraction, how you need to have this type of mindset. Completely. Completely. Everything completely outweighs nothing. Doesn't matter what it is. It's all in the same category of completely outweighing nothing. Completely. 100%. Totally. You can't measure how much. Can you measure how much a feather outweighs nothing? Can you measure that at all? The outweighingness, can you measure it? That part. There's nothing to measure, right? And it's like that. Reality, there's nothing to measure about reality. It's not how much does reality outweigh nothing. Nothing, there's nothing there at all. There's no question how much. There's no question of how much at all. So I'm a friend of Longchenpa. I'm a brother of Longchenpa. Longchenpa is like a brother to me. He's a brother. That's how I see it. What a brother to have. I can't put it into words. You talk about someone holding steady in the truth. Wow. It's 100% steady. Like Ron Maharshi, you know, like you see that steadiness. You talk about it's 100%, it's completely steady. Because what is there to weigh steadiness against? Really, nothing. How could you weigh yourself against nothing? So he's no longer trying to weigh himself against nothing. So it's completely steady. And undistracted. And clear. That's the mind that he has for us. It says, this is your mind too. And as long as you stop the silliness, absurdity, this is the same mind. This is your mind also. It's all one mind like this. So sure, there's bad news in the world, but I want to tell you, the good news totally outweighs it. Not to the complete sense of nothingness, which ultimately it is true, it is nothing. But it may be a little difficult for us to see that at this point. Or maybe not, I don't know. But when we can drop this whole idea of outweighs and just realize just completely, there's nothing to measure, there's nothing to even say about it. What can we say that's meaningful in terms of weight and weighing when one side of the scale has nothing on it? At that point, words become absurd, don't they? In terms of trying to describe the weighing. There's no weighing. But let us just say that the good news is that there is no weighing. And this is greatly overshadows the turmoil in the world. Greatly overshadows it, like it's always just, you know, it's just a little scrap in the corner, really. Of no importance, really, whatsoever, actually. So we have this perspective, ultimately going towards the ultimate perspective. So I know it's a little awkward trying to compare the two, you know, because I have to kind of see things in two different ways here. So we won't dwell on it. Let's just say the great good news is it's not easily pulled down at all, okay? Ron Maharshi said it, just mind seeing mind, I, mind seeing mind. Just to turn the mind around and let mind just look at mind instead of seeking for some other mind. Dude, right now, mind's looking for some other mind and it's not looking at itself to realize that it's complete. There's nothing competing with it. There's nothing on the other side of the scale at all. And just looking at it from that perspective, mind looking at mind like that. Don't try to understand this intellectually. Don't try to understand it. Just hear it. and just say, "Wow, I didn't know that. I didn't really know that. I'm not up to speed on that. Okay, let me just have faith that in hearing that, I will get up to speed because I want to. This is my intention. This is my purpose." Don't go into it intellectually at all. Use your faith in the Holy Spirit and the great teachers. They will bring you to this. This is their purpose. They will help attune you to this. I am that. I am that. Not I found that. I am that. So I change the banner and the website back and forth, this and this and that, depending on what's current right now. Longchamp is very much current right now, big time, big time. We just don't know. I don't know what these bodhisattvas could do. I really don't know. They're off the charts. So just say, I don't know. I really don't know. They're so competent that no possible way I can really evaluate, the magnitude of help they can give us is just immeasurable. I cannot fathom it. And we're going to become aware of that. I had that dream when these gigantic elephants picked me off this world and said, "Would you want some help with getting down? You seem stuck up there." And I said, "Yeah." And they lifted me right off of there so easily. Then they said, "You see that place over there through space or some place?" I said, "Yeah, that light, that beautiful light in the distance." They said, "Yeah." I said, "You like to go there?" I said, "Yeah, let's go." They said, "Okay, we're going there. So you want to come with us?" I said, "Yeah, absolutely, let's go." And so they started taking me there. The lighted land. The land of beautiful light. This is the power of these bodhisattvas is enormous. We don't even think we can understand it. These elephants were gigantic. They're bigger than the entire world. That's how big these elephants were. We think we know a little something about spiritual stuff, or like little elephants, little baby elephants running around, trumpeting, frisking and showing how powerful we are and bumping into stuff, and we think we're really awesome and stuff. But, did you see these big elephants? You realize, wow, I'm just a little ant, a little ant elephant. So it helps our humility. Is sure, study all you want, but still say, "Yeah, I really don't know anything. I really don't." And seeing the truth, you realize it's not really expressible in comparative terms, really, because this is the recognition of no comparison. And words are really based on comparison. If there is no comparison, how do we how can you really express that so much in words and no comparison at all? There's no weight on the other side of the scale. None. So why do we need a scale? Right? Why do we even need to weigh, judge? There's nothing there to weigh or to judge. So just do a lot of little things for yourself that make you feel better about yourself. Yeah, maybe get a nice shirt or something. I got a nice shirt here. Make sure that you're able to do something you feel competent. You feel competent at it, and you feel pretty competent. And thank God, I hope I've got this golf thing a little bit, so it's going my way a little, going my way now, maybe a lot. It's something I enjoy doing. It's you're out in really gorgeous landscape, very serene, very quiet, very peaceful. You completely forget about the world. It's fun. It's you get to dress up. You get to wear all white. You go wearing all white in the golf course. That's fine. People don't think that you're an ice cream man or something. You're a golfer out there. You wear the white belt. Rocking the white belt. You got to rock the white belt and the white shoes out on the golf course. Come on. I got the white hat. And of course, white is the symbol of peace and calm and serenity and completeness and no contrastiness. Okay, so I wear a lot of white now, no contrast there. And it's beautiful, it's really beautiful. I can say. Some of the most beauty I've ever seen, maybe the most, is on some golf courses, and it's just you just say, wow, it's like the Garden of Eden. It's amazing. I mean the grass grows right down to the ponds, right into the ponds, and it's all mown right into the ponds. Where do you see that? It's just the ponds are all sparkly and clean, and everything is just like. There's no weeds. It's just the grass is perfect, and it's mowed so close and beautifully, and you're just walking. What am I doing here? What is this? It's really a very interesting experience. And when you're driving the golf course, you don't have to worry about traffic. It's just so difficult to drive, especially the Silicon Valley. It's extraordinarily difficult now. So stressful. This is what I have to do every day. Just driving a golf course, I don't have to worry about other cars. It's so cool to do that. And it's not dangerous. I've never crashed a golf cart. It's not gonna flip over. So you kind of drive and not pay attention, take video. You don't really need to pay too much attention where you're going. And you can drive out on the golf course and go wherever you want to go. You want to go this way, you want to go that way. You feel very free, It's very free. It's this feeling I can drive anywhere I want to. I'm off-road. There's nothing stopping me. There's no boulder stopping me or anything. I go anywhere. It's just a lovely, lovely experience to experience this. I'm in control of where I'm going. I can drive up here, I can drive down there, and nobody's yelling at me and looking at me and saying, "Hey, what are you doing?" No, you got a right to drive out on the golf course. Unless they say it's cart pass only, if it's rained real bad or they overseeded or something. But most of the time, you don't drive on the greens, of course. Carts have to go off before you get close to the green. And then you can just walk anywhere on a golf course. There's no policing, no bureaucracy policing you, saying where you could walk. You can even go over to the next fairway, hit your ball, maybe walk over the next fairway, just wave to the place. Ball, okay, they'll wait and hit it. You go anywhere. You go anywhere. So there's so much freedom there, actually. You go in the bushes looking for your ball, tromping around. I do that all the time. You're just in a jungle. You go in the jungle. You go. Nobody's gonna tell you can't do it. This is the cool thing about golf, because everybody's in the same boat. They understand. It's a shared mentality out there. Nobody's gonna tell you what to do out there, really, unless you really don't know what you're doing. If you know what you're doing, I mean, if you're causing some harm or troubles, but if you know what you're doing, nobody's gonna tell me like, "Hey, what are you doing? You can't, You look like you're competent, you're out there and you're enjoying yourself," and they are too. They mind their business, you mind your business. So everybody has in a great mood out there, really. And politics is gone, religious differences are gone, social differences are gone, everything, you're like equals out there. You're all going through this ordeal together, and everybody helps one another out there. I do recommend people getting, I'm going to get those envelopes you put your debit card or credit card in, these metal envelopes that shield it from scanners, because somebody definitely scanned my card, debit card, and I think I know who did it, actually. Yeah, it's pretty interesting. There's a lot of that taking place, and there'll be a lot more of that taking place. Where they get your car, they're close enough to you, they got opportunity, they can scan your wallet, your purse, and get your number from your debit card. I don't know how they, you know, manage it. My card's chipped, and they still got the number. So they make wallets that block it. They make these little sleeves you slip your card into, like little credit card sleeves. I think I'm going to get some of those, because it happens to the best of us, happens to all of us, right? I mean, there's so much criminality going on now. It's just off the charts, and it's going to get a lot worse coming up. So protect that. I'm going to look into that. I forgot about that, but yeah. Because I was talking about that with someone today, and they said, oh yeah. Yeah, that's a good idea. We both said that's a good idea. I told him. He said, was it chipped? I said, yeah. He said, wow. They're supposed to try to make it more difficult. No. No. He got it right away. It's amazing. So, second time. Other times a credit card. That's doing something good for yourself right there, right? There's something you can do for yourself. These are things that you can do, make you feel a little safer, make you feel a little better about yourself as we consider the great help that we're getting and becoming at least cognizant of there's great help that we're getting now that is so great we really don't know, can't say much about it. But we are kind of start trying to tune into that radio station a bit, right? Tuning in a little, it's like there's a station, there's this great music, oh, the music is just so wonderful, and we're trying to tune into the station, and, you know, static, and kind of trying to get our transistor tuned into that better, our crystal tuned into that radio station, so we can hear this music, wow, hear this peace, feel this peace, feel the stability, because stability is where it's at, isn't it? It is where it's at now. Is really where it's at. So everyone needs to do what makes them feel really stable. Really stable, truly stable, and going towards more stability. You know, out with the cheap thrills, okay? Out with the cheap thrills. We're talking about stability. We want stability. Because there's boat's getting rocked, isn't it? Really rocked. Going to get severely rocked. We're really going to get severely rocked now coming up. Rocking back and forth. It means instability, right? Severely barocked with severe instability. Now, the shoe certainly seems to fit, but if it doesn't fit, then okay, it doesn't fit. Seems to fit awfully well. Really okay. But, keep an open mind to that too. Hindsight will tell. At any rate, we're going to get rocked very severely coming up. So the more stability we have, the better. The more access we have to those who are supremely stable, the better. The more supremely stable ones we have access to, the better. It's like that. It's a time to be ecumenical right now. And stability is where you find it. It's who shows up, you know, is where it's at right now, is where it's really at. amazing thing happened today. I was behind this gate, this place, working behind this gate, this gated place, and three people showed up at the gate. They said, we just stopped, and we want to take a look at the house. And so they were kind of grabbing the gate and looking through the gate, the house and stuff, and I said, okay. Then I went over and chatted with them, and one of them was a man, and one was like maybe his mother, and one was a friend of his mother or something. The man was like about my age, about. He had a tweed sport coat on, and his shoes were all paint splattered, and he was just, you know, and he had this sort of a Rasta hat on, like a baggy hat. Maybe he had really long hair. It was underneath the hat or something. He's an American guy. It reminded me of my dad, actually. He looked a very odd combination of dress, to say the least. He looked like sort of a hippie intellectual or something, academic. And had very intelligent eyes to some extent. And he said he lives on 40 acres up in the Santa Cruz Mountains. That's where he lives, 40 acres up there. It's a lot, 40 acres, isn't it? Yeah. And his mom lives in town, and she said, I'm a very nature girl, you know, I really just love nature. And so that's where they get their peace. And then their friend, she had this golf hat on, and she said, no, I'm just the opposite. My house is like manicured, everything's taken care of so nicely, and they just let their things go to nature, you know, just let the weeds happen, let all this stuff happen. She says, no, everything's taken really good care of. And I said, you know, I like that. I said, that's really cool. Love that too. And when they're leaving, I made some comment to her about, you know, I said, well, you're taking that, you know, hey, golf. I said, where are you going? You're going back to your place in the mountains? And anyway, I said, where are you going? You go back to your golf course or something? She's laughed. And I said, you know, I like that. Maybe I'm going to do that too. And so there's different strokes for different folks, okay? And being behind a gate, like a gated community, they couldn't, they actually took the knocker and they were say, oh, this is nice, because you put some rubber there, and it so it doesn't go clang, clang, clang real loud, the bump, 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 because the rubber keeps it from doing that. And they said, oh, I like that. And they were really into this and looking at this, and it's like, wow, lovely. But I didn't open the gate. I didn't have the authority to do that. I don't know if they wanted to come in or not. I'm not sure, you know, exactly what to make of it all. Except it has something to do with, where do you find refuge? You know, he seemed like he was going, well, the idea for me was, maybe people will start thinking about taking refuge in gated communities or something like that, right? Sort of a peaceful place that's sort of beyond the world, like a reduced intensity zone. Maybe a reduced intensity zone is where it's at, and they were like really interested in it. Yeah. Maybe hiding out in the woods isn't going to be all that great. I'm not really into that. I'm not into that. I appreciate it as an adventure thing, but give me a beautiful gated community with a gorgeous, sparkling golf course, and just the peace is just, you feel so civilized and spacious, very spacious, and very calm, peaceful. And everyone's able to function there in a way that's very respectful of one another. Activities happening, but it's all really kindly peaceful, and we're struggling, but it's okay, it doesn't matter. It's all good. It's all good. There's not some struggle for survival taking place there. You know, it just seems like it's all under control and it's all serene. There's something about it. So, you know, I'll go for that. I go for that. I'm not really like a survivalist out in the mountains. It's not my style. A reduced intensity zone. So we're going to get rocked. Worst way that this world's ever been rocked before. We're most certainly going to be rocked. And yet, that's just this silly little side trip that really carries no weight at all, actually. It's just we're all bringing our sacrificial offerings to the altar. to the altar of the empty tomb. And we just keep on doing that. You know, at some point you laugh and it's just silly. So I'm just not into that anymore. And just seeing everyone from that perspective, that's profound, very profound. That it's really just spirit. The bodies are just these offerings. Imagine if you're carrying a bunch of flowers to your mom's grave or something, right? Laying it on a tomb, and you're just carrying these flowers to lay at this tomb. The body's just like a bunch of flowers we're carrying, or some offering, you know, we're carrying. We're just carrying this offering to the, and our death, the corpse of our body, is our offering to this tomb. So when life is just our walking towards this tomb, we're carrying this body so we can lay this corpse. Then we withdraw our breath from it, and the body's then a corpse. It's really a corpse right now. I mean, really, it's not alive, actually. We're just breathing. We're just pretending, or, you know, we're in transit to Corpseville, you know, laying it upon us as a corpse upon this empty tomb, altar of this empty tomb. That's all it is. That's all that it is. We're just in, everyone's in transit towards that. That's all they're doing. They're not the body at all. The spirit's just moving this corpse towards this empty tomb, preparing it, you know, preparing it. Another way of putting it, they're making all this preparation so that the sacrifice has meaning, we hope, has some meaning. This corpse body is supposed to have some meaning, you know. It did this, it did this, it did nothing. It did nothing. The body does nothing. Nothing at all. We can never have the body do anything. The body's never doing anything. It's not even breathing. We're breathing the body, actually. Body's not doing anything, really. We're doing everything right now, this instant. Getting a little chilly out here. How are we doing here? What? Okay, good. So, yeah, get your kombucha on. Get your kombucha on. Get your probiotic on. Well, I've never taken probiotics, but I do eat a lot of yogurt for sure. My digestive system seems to be a lot better than it was this summer, which I was going real bad. I could tell my whole system was going downhill. But I said, "What the? Who cares? You know, I mean, this, the world's going downhill, and why try to preserve the body?" But the Holy Spirit said, "Yeah, that's true. It's, you know, but you know, in order to be helpful to others, why don't you, you know, see if you can be helpful? Maybe be helpful and set a good example." So I said, "Okay, set a good example here." People are going to need to have this rudimentary stuff too, that at least I'm doing something good for myself. I say, yeah, okay, I understand. That's good. I understand that. So I'm bumping and I'm pumping up. And yeah, those rubber bands are nice. I like them. Someone recommended I do that. A friend, you know, the guy is really tuned in, and I said, why don't you try it? You know, it's really helpful. And I ordered them on Amazon, and they came, and it's great. I love it. I love it. It's a kind of resistance that doesn't really hurt you too much, but you can feel it's really, you know, it's really going to make you feel more flexible and stronger in some way. It's cool. It's really cool. I used to have these springs when I was younger with handles on both sides, and they're hooked. These handles, and like four springs between these two handles, you pull them apart, you know. It's like the Charles Atlas. You got to build up, you know, strong pectoral muscles and shoulders and start doing these springs. Yeah, yeah, it never really worked. I never built up anything. I did not, never had a, you know, robust physique, kind of muscled physique. I did not. I was shadow boxing last night. That's a nice exercise to do, actually, shadow boxing. I imagine you're like in the ring and you're dodging, you know, someone. You're not landing blows. You're just fending off blows, and you're moving this way and that way. I did that. I was like very good at it. It's like, wow, I could really move now, because that has to do with your core and your legs. Overall, you can tell your overall fitness if you can shadow box really well. Well, I think like the Floyd Mayweather, a really good boxer, it's really hard to hit him. Yeah, he's just so agile and can move and slide and glide and turn and just slip this and that. He's just dancing. He's just in the ring dancing, kind of. You know, but it's all spontaneous, because you never know. He's never fixated in any particular stance. You know, so you're shadow boxing. You're not fixated. You never know which way you're gonna move. You know, where is it coming? It's coming from this angle. Ah, I can go this way. And this angle, I can duck, you know, and I can spin. And so you feel like you can just do any sort of maneuver. There is, really. If I need to flatten down, I can flatten down. If I need to jump up, I can jump up. I can make myself thin, I can make myself thin. And shrug this way, shrug that way. Yeah. So, I mean, you're a dancer, get your dance on. I mean, one thing I'm always just amazed at is how good dancers women are. They're just, I don't know, I can't explain it at all. I don't know how they do it. It's especially young women. I was looking at this video back in the 60s of these, in France. It was Spencer Davis Group on some French television show. There's all these young women there dancing, and it's like they're so good. It's just insane. I mean, And in the 60s, all these dancers, and a lot of them had the videos back then, and the TV shows had these women dancing. And they're so good. I don't understand how they do it. I really don't. They're just so rhythmic and intuitive about moving in different ways. I just can't do that, you know? And most men cannot dance like that. Women are better dancers. Some men can. Some men, but not as good as women. Women win the prize when it comes to dancing, is for sure. Quite astonishing. The really good ones when they're young, oh my gosh. So amazing. So if you're a good dancer, you know, dance. Make sure you can dance really good right now, because that's very, you know, men can do like the shadow boxing thing, which, you know, we're probably pretty good at. There's stuff that we're good at too, right? I don't compete with dancing with women. I don't even try. I never tried. Never even tried. You know, I just said, hey, that's out of my league for sure. Don't waste my time even attempting to try to dance like that. Something to do with the overall structure and the way they're wired and everything like that. You know, it's just different. They just throw a beat down, and then they can just like interpret it 100,000 different ways. And each one of them is like, you know, wow. I just shuffle my feet. But shadow boxing, oh man, I can really move. I can really, really move well. Get up on your toes, dancing. Like, you know, Muhammad Ali back in the day. He's up on his toes. He starts getting up on his toes. He's motoring. And he's just floating. Just float. Get it. Start floating up on your balls of your feet. Try that as an exercise. And rope-a-dope. We might have to do some rope-a-dope, folks, I tell you that. And Muhammad Ali actually was a cultural icon in terms of showing us a certain way to get through severe times. One way to do it, which is the rope-a-dope thing, and just let the opponent beat them, you know, wear themselves out trying to beat on you. And you just keep covering up and keep covering up and keep slipping, and just let them think that they just throw all their strength at you. And at some point, their arms will just be worn out. That's what he did. He just allowed himself to be, he was good at defending, but he didn't do the dodging thing. He let them hit him. He let himself be hit. And the ones swinging so hard, they their shoulders would get tired, their arms would get tired, and they couldn't lift their arms anymore. And then he hadn't been really throwing many punches, and then he'd come out and start dancing around and start jabbing, and they couldn't protect anyone. They couldn't get their arms up quick enough. And then he was so fast that he just pum, you know, start pummeling them. They had no more defense. But he would play the rope-a-dope and tire them out. So, but of course this resulted in severe, what does he have, Parkinson's or something. He's really messed up badly. Took too many blows to the head. It was terrifying watching him get hit. It was awful. I didn't like him. I didn't like that type of defense, really. I know many people thought he was wonderful. I didn't think so. No, I said he's stupid. But there's something there. Okay, to be said, is there at times you may have to do a rope-a-dope if you're getting caught, if you're getting hit. If you're getting hit, go into that rope-a-dope thing and, you know, it cover up and sag back against the rope. So they were like slugging as hard as they could. They'd hit him, but he'd go back against the elastic ropes and the ropes would help absorb the force of the blow. And so it wouldn't hurt him that bad. But the guy throwing it put all his effort into it, so he's getting tired. So he allowed the elasticity of the ropes and his body to somewhat nullify the injurious effect upon himself. So that's the rope-a-dope is one thing. I think we can do better in rope-a-dope, but keep that in mind. That is some, if you happen to be getting hit by the world's hitting you, you know, you just kind of allow yourself to rock with it and absorb it, some of it, and not too much of it. Okay, that's okay. Do that. That's a rudimentary technique, you might say. So we'll get better techniques here. They're coming up. One technique coming right up. I was doing accents today. I never tried. I could be pretty decent at it, actually. I figured out how they do it. I understand these guys who do all these imitations. They can imitate people. Some of them actually kind of explain how they do it. And I've sort of picked up on that explanation of how they do it. So I was doing all these different things. I was just like doing really well at some of it. It is a certain attitude and psychology of the way people speak. And then you understand that attitude and psychology, and then where the breath hits the mouth, how the mouth, you know, you're talking in the jowls, you're talking, is it labial, you know, the lips? Are you kind of whispering out? Does it come just kind of like, you know, California cool? Oh, wow, that's awesome. Yeah, it's just you're kind of just letting the air kind of go out like that. Yeah, really use your mouth at all. Then, oh yeah, we're gonna go to Big Sur. Yeah, I was thinking, like, maybe we go to Big Sur this weekend. It should be really beautiful there. You know, that's California. The way the Californians talk is just like, it's so beautiful here. You know, I'm just kind of hardly. It's kind of almost like a golf talk. You don't talk very much at all. Very loud. And we're laid back. Oh yeah, I think maybe we should go to the beach. I went to the beach last week. It was like really beautiful at the beach. You know, we're just hanging out. And, oh, yeah. It's so great. It's so beautiful all the time here. And I just kind of feel relaxed and, you know, so calm. And I just kind of feel like saying, it's so beautiful. Look at those beautiful trees. And so as your breath is just kind of sighing out, you kind of form soft words as the breath comes out. That's California. That's kind of how we talk. It's really, it's a different places, you know, their history and stuff. You know, the Irish, you know, they're like biting off their anger, each word, you know, I can't really say what I want to say, because there's the bloody, you know, the English are gonna chop me head off. So you got to keep the clip, you know, clip the clip down there and keep it really on. And it's in the, you know, the growl's coming up, but I gotta clip off the thing and not say too much about it. And bloody, so they're real angry. They're real angry, but they can't express the anger. So there's always like biting the head of the anger off, you know, as they're talking. And if you get into that psychology of that, then it's like Irish, just like you can just speak it beautifully. It's like, oh my gosh, you know, because you, this is their thing. They're so bitter and angry, and I, yes, I come from the land of the bogs and the little people. It's so tough. It is right. So they really want to just be angry, but they can't. They can't. So they're like choking off the anger. So if you just have this idea of choking off the anger and still have to talk, you know, like this, it comes out like an Irishman. The British aristocracy, oh, that's a great one, you know, you really have to get into it, it's not, and what it is like, they're not in the same realm as you are, actually, and they're kind of, you know, they kind of speak, I don't know if I can do it right now, I'm not in the mood, but it's, as lovely, of course, as lovely, you know, we're not really breathing the same air that you're breathing, you understand that, but that's all right. And so the nose is kind of blocked up because we don't quite want to breathe, you know, the stench of who we're speaking to. We're kind of up here. It's very condescending. It's very condescending because we're not having the same experiences as you are. We're in this lovely realm and everything is quite beautiful and quite nice and quite charming, quite civilized. And we're talking to this, you know, garbage in front of us, but we don't want to, you know, upset them too much. So we're going to be, you know, it's very condescending. And they can't understand our experiencing at all. It's just breeding, you know, we're born into it. And there's nothing anyone can do about it. And no pleasure oblige, you know, there's no pleasure oblige here. There's a little bit stuffy because they want to keep they don't want to smell who they're talking to, you know. It's a little bit standoffish there, you know, because we don't really, really want to engage with who we're talking with. We're talking with the natives, and we don't want to go native here. So it's this whole super condescending thing that it's in the voice there. I'm not doing it good right now. Today I was doing it very well, but it's funny. I mean, I'll crack myself up. I don't want to do that. But they're really, you know, really not here, sharing the same realm at all, you see. And it's really not something that we can explain, you understand. But it's there, nothing we could do about it. And it's just the way things are. And, of course. Lovely idea you had there, you know. It's like they're talking to someone that is garbage, basically. But they don't really want to hurt the feelings of the little people, you know, they're suffering so much already. It got to be nice and don't really rub it in, you know. That wouldn't be civilized to rub it in, but, you know. And it's, you know, it's a bit tedious speaking this way. But the greatness, you know, will put up with it, stiff upper lip, and we'll have put up with it, talking to the little people, the rabble, and the rubble and the rabble. No, not at all, no trouble at all, there's no trouble at all, nothing, you know, nothing's stressing me. I make a little tweak here, you know, nothing's out of whack at all, it's something, it's a problem, it's, oh, sure, of course, we make a little tweak here, and everything will be lovely, everything will be fine, you know, like, there's no worries, everything is perfect order here, what are you talking, I mean, you don't understand, you can't see it, you can't experience it, but I'm experiencing it, and everything is just absolutely spot on perfect here, it's so nice. And, oh, there's a little something. Okay, no trouble at all. No trouble at all. Don't trouble yourself over that. You know, it's kind of like, you know, it's a psychiatrist talking to their patient or something, too. You know, it's hilarious. I mean, you get the condescending style down in their attitude, and you can see it. I got into the role of it. You know, it's just like, it's hilarious. It's like they know that you just can't understand them at all. Not at all. There's not even any slightest possibility that you can understand them in any way. But don't trouble yourself about it, old chap, you know? Yeah, just complete aplomb, you know. It's not, but it's natural to us, you know. So it's not really aplomb because it's just the way things are, you see. Can't really explain it, you know. Savoir faire, but not worked at all. It's effortless. There's no effort at all to maintain this whatsoever, you see. It's just something. It's not anything that we ever worked at or had to struggle straight. It's just completely natural to us. And it can never be natural to you. And but what can we say about it? What can we do about it? You know, it's really something that we just have to accept, you see. That's the upper class British, British thing, and then there's the sort of the working class British thing, Governor. Right, Governor, get it right away, Governor. And it's kind of like real brisk and eager and bulldogish, and we're gonna get this done. It, you know, it basically said we're gonna show those aristocrats that we're really the ones that are really talented. We're the really, you know, they don't. What do you mean they don't understand us? You know, I mean, look how efficient we can be. Look, you know, really we're gonna. It's kind of. It's like, absolutely can do, Governor, no problem whatsoever. We're going to get this done right now. And put a spot polish on it, and you know, just cheery, very cheerio, really cheery full of cheer. And, you know, we're going to show them that we're not too bothered either, even though, you know. And, you get this very funny psychology of everybody in the world has this kind of psychology based on their history and their culture and everything. I find the British is the most intimidating because they simply put on airs that they're in a different realm than you are, and you can't even see the realm they're in. You're completely blind to it. And they're talking with you, but the attitude is that you really can't understand me at all. It's not even worth trying, but we'll humor you. You know, we'll humor you. It just feels like they have to humor everybody. Just humoring them, condescending with it, but trying to be nice. But that comes natural too, you know. Just breeding it. Bemused, they're kind of bemused at all the little ants that are just struggling around. I said, if it's a worker, the help will take care of that. You know, they're bred for that, and it's really none of our concern. Everything will be fine, don't worry about a thing. It has its place, you know. This ultimate aplomb, just absolute aplomb, and je ne sais quoi, But not even trying to do it, you know. It's just breathing, old chap, you know. And everything in his family lineage has just been easy, no trouble. A few little tweaks here and there we made, but it was nothing. It was nothing. Yeah, well, what about the battle back, 1,000 years ago, your ancestors, a terrible battle, and they lost, somebody. Those things happen, This happens, there's no trouble at all, really. A few things got a bit out of whack, and we made a few tweaks, and everything was fine. Hey, so all the panic's in you. There's no panic in them at all. All the panic's in you. Panic, they don't even know what that is. Sure, our castle got stormed, and half our people got slaughtered, everything, but no trouble at all, really. Really, it's just one of those things. I realize I have this funny combination in my own psyche of ancestry and reincarnation and stuff. I've got both the aristocratic British, I've got the working class British, and I've got the Irish. And the Irish, they're great sufferers, And they're just good at what I have to slog on through. Yeah. And they're very good at just slogging on through and making do. It's a lot on life, and so it enables me to go through all this terrible suffering I've gone through, and it's just, it's the Irish in me that just says, well, it's one of those things, my lot in life, I've got to make the best of it, I'm not going to let this defeat me. You're getting, pounded, you're just absolutely pummeled in the... You say, fine, I'm not going to let this defeat me, get me down. And so that's a good combination to have some Irish in you, because you're going to suffer this world. They have a very good attitude towards suffering. And then you need to have some briskness on the spiritual path and brisk confidence. You can get it done, real industrious, brisk confidence of the working class British. And then you need to have this, just this imperturbability of the British aristocrats, of that, shrug everything off is just, full stop in the wow is just no trouble at all, really. Really, if you look at it the right way, it's not to be bothered, no bother whatsoever. This graciousness, this sort of this grand graciousness of it all, that helps too. It helps too. And then you get some of the American in there, and some of the German, the German perfectionism, says, "I'm going to work on this until I get it perfect." And the American doggedness, nothing can get me down, We're going to win. We're going to win. Get that Texan. Get some of that Texan. Just confidence. Real confidence. We are tough. And we are strong. And nobody's going to push us around. We're going to get it done. And then the California cool of just... everything's beautiful. Totally used to this beauty, and I just belong here. I just belong. And you get these wonderful combinations in your psyche. Use them as strengths. The Irish just keep coming back for more. It doesn't matter how they get pounded, and they keep getting back on their feet, and that helps a lot on the spiritual path, because you just get absolutely crushed, just so many times. Irish jump out of bed in the morning and say, "Let's go at it again. You want to pummel me again? Let's see how you pummel me this time, my lad." The fighting Irish, is like, "Maybe this time I'll get the best of you. You haven't got me down yet. You're still fighting, So that fighting attitude is like, "What do you mean? What do you mean? How'd that beat? I'm not beat. I'm not licked. I hadn't even begun to fight yet. What are you talking about? I'm just warming up." And the British would be, the aristocracy, Is this some little trouble there? What trouble? No, just a little spot of trouble. Don't worry yourself about it. You know, dear, it's nothing at all. Nothing at all. You're not my bad, no matter bad you're suffering, whatever it is. It's like, don't even worry about it, you know. It's not even worth even getting the slightest concern about it. Well, what's that? That's nothing at all. Nothing. Oh, you know, you feel sick. Sick. No. Just a slight little trouble. It's gone. It's gone. It's not button on bother at all. So the attitude of no matter how much you're suffering, it's really nothing at all. It's not even worth even noticing. Some of my breathing, you know, we don't even take notice of that stuff. It's not relevant at all. No matter how bad it gets, it's really, don't worry about it. Everything's great. Everything's fine. Everything's lovely. Lovely day today, really. Now, that's more of a Cockney countryside accent, but they're nice little sarcastic today. It's a lovely day, huh? Yeah, there's Socrates. He says, it's I'm here, it's a lovely day. Yeah, it's always a lovely day. What do you mean, lovely day? It's always a lovely day. It's not a lovely day, but of course. Yeah, things are really good, going good for you. Oh, yes, of course. Splendid, really. It's absolutely splendid. People ask me, how are you doing? I say, I'm doing absolutely fantastic, of course. I don't just say, how are you doing? Yeah, I'm doing okay. I'm not licked yet. You know, I don't say that. I say, how I feel? I feel absolutely fantastic. Like, you don't even need that. You need to ask? Are you kidding me? You don't need to ask, really. But for the sake of appearances, of course, we'll ask. But you know, never been better. Everything's just, you know, perfect. Everything's perfect. So there you go. There's some secrets for you. Those are very good stability devices. Just call on your inner strengths of your ancestry and the characteristics that you know they have, and you can borrow some from other whatever seems to work. But I gotta admire the aplomb of the British as they walk through, you know, just the streets of Calcutta or Bombay or something, you know, dressed in their Sunday whites or something, and ladies with the parasols. I dare say, you know, what a pity, you know, what a pity that, and it looks like that one's having a bit of spot of trouble right there. We must do something about this. But it's a, you know, lovely day today, and chipper, cheerful, heads up, and it's like just sailing right on through, skating right on through. So how you doing? Lovely, what are you doing? Splendid. It's all splendid. It's amazing stuff. Very good stuff. Helpful stuff. How are we doing today? Absolutely splendid, of course. But of course, it's splendid, old chap. Have a little bit of fun with it. I have fun with the southern accents of the United States. You know, there's all every state has a different southern accent, actually. You know, Georgia's in the jowls. You know, Georgia's always in the jowls, like they have jowls. Louisiana's like a mouth of salivating and like you just because you did some like some really tasty jambalaya over there, and there's a mouth of salivating, so all this saliva's in there, juicy's mouth, and you gotta talk with your kind of your lips there, and it's just, and it's different. Georgia is talking with the teeth, they talk with the teeth. Hi, I'm Jim Akata, I talk with my teeth. From Georgia, I'm Pina Farr from Georgia. And we're talking a clip that talk the front of the mouth like this. So it's all the parts of the mouth, you know, Arkansas. Yeah, hard to do it now. It's too cold, but it's too cold out here to do it. You need to be warm. You need to be really warm when you do it. So your all the muscles in your mouth, everything, you can just just focus on different breath and how it hits your mouth in different places and how you kind of talk like this and. Top of the mouth, bottom of the mouth, lips, talking with the lips like this, and talking that down here in Louisiana, we're kind of talking with our lips down here. It's just our lips, there's nothing else, it's all talking with our lips. Georgia talking with the teeth. Texas talking like Texas, like this, tick, 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 tick. The breath is like hitting the front of the mouth, like guns, gunfire, you know. Everything's, sure, everything's tall down here in Texas. What do you think, boy? It's really good down here in Texas. We do things big down here in Texas. We're going to, kind of clenched jaw. Everything's real straight and real honest down here in Texas. Everything's big and bright in Texas. I'm going to show you a good time down here in Texas. I think you really like the people down here. So it's set jaw, clenched jaw. The breath of, you know, hitting the teeth like that. Like a petroleum thing, two or something. So we're just cooling down here. It just, I want everybody to feel like happy and funny and like competent and, you know, a spot of trouble, really, really, yeah. It's a shame, really. Yeah. Oh, I just got my polo match coming up here. I have a lovely day. It's, you know, really, because we have, our future is just tremendous. You can't even describe how great it's going to be, actually. So why get bothered over, you know, a bit of trouble, a spot of trouble? What a shame. But, you know, it's like they always say, well, yeah, but civilization will smooth it all out. You know, we got no troubles whatsoever. We're gonna just make a little alteration there, a little tweak, it'll be fine. No trouble whatsoever. Okay? Nothing spoils my serenity. Nothing can spoil my serenity. They're not even something even worth even thinking about. It's not even possible, actually. Now, use whatever you could use to just feel like my serenity, my happiness, my peace, everything is just who I am. That's what I am. It's who I am. Nothing to say about it. It's who I am. Now, British aristocracy comes from those who were victorious in war. So from their standpoint is basically say, well, we won. That's it. End of the story. We won. We're winners. Game over. And so they have this warrior thing of the winners feel, you know, it's when you win, you win. You lose, but we won. So there's nothing else to talk about. Nothing to talk about at all. Got the paintings on the wall, the show it, you know. Got all these battle scenes on our walls. Yeah, we won. Game over. So for them, there's nothing to prove. What do you prove it to? The losers, they're in the ground. You know, they're gone. We're here. We won. So that's the warrior class of the successful warrior class, which are the British aristocracy. The warrior class, all right. Aristocracy, you have the warriors, warrior class of the winners. To the victors go the spoils. So we've already won. See, the thing is, we've already won. You have to have this attitude. We've already won. Whatever you want, there's no contest. We've won the contest. In fact, there was no contest, and actually, there was no contest. We're even beyond winning. We're beyond even being contested. We're incontestable, actually. We're completely incontestable. That's all there is to it. What does Ramana need to say? He says, silence is like a continuous eternal language. Unending speech. Unending speech. Just unending speech. So he doesn't need to say anything because he can say everything. He's saying everything. So why does he need to say anything in particular? He's so uncontestable. He's saying everything. Endlessly saying everything. I need to stoop to saying something. Not really. No. He might smile and say, ask, you know, who's asking the question? I say, look who's asking that question. But these gurus are not putting on airs. It's no pretension. It's no condescension. It's the real thing. It's the real thing. They know it. They see it. They're experiencing it. There's nothing that can be contested. The mind cannot be contested, okay? The mind cannot be contested. This is very important to hear this. The mind cannot be contested. And they know this is true. So all this silly sacrificial offerings we're making, you know, is as if that this is adding up to some contestment of mind is just a ridiculous joke to them. You know, it's just hilariously silly joke that somebody's carrying another corpse to lay on the pile. Pile away, you know. It means absolutely nothing. That's the viewpoint they have. It means absolutely nothing. And yet we're so tired of piling these corpses on the pile, you know. We say, I got to pile another one on the pile. And they say, okay, we'll help you. Listen, yeah, that's some mercy. Say, listen, you don't need to do that. You don't need to keep doing that. Yeah, but it hasn't worked yet. Maybe this one will work. He says, no, it'll never work. What? No, there's no other mind. There's nothing, the mind can't be contested. There's no, you know, you don't need to try and generate some other mind with this corpse. You don't need to pile your corpse on the pile. Give it up right now. In fact, you've never done anything. Nothing's ever been laid on the pile. It's just the mind projecting time. The time and space are within the mind. We are, and we are the mind. So it's not outside of the mind. There's nothing that's ever been outside of the mind. We keep thinking that we're putting something, piling up this pile outside of the mind. We're not doing that at all. Everything is now in the mind. Mind is projecting everything right now. It's always projecting all it's experiencing is always right now. It's just all projecting all of this. It's just the creativity is so extraordinary. We think that's not possible, but it is. Every sensation, every belief we have in time is being in space is being projected by the mind this very instant. And that's true each and every instant, freshly projected every instant. So nothing at all is happening as far as time or space. It's all just the mind right now. So keep on looking at these videos. I'm putting up videos of some a playlist of Rana Maharshi. I have on the YouTube website. Practicing. Just I made a screensaver. I went to in the operating system. Went to a Windows picture gallery or something, and then you click on some extras or utilities or something. You click on up on top menu and you find screensaver. Click on screensaver. You go in there and then you can choose a file of pictures to have as your screensaver, and it'll play those like a slideshow. And you can choose the transitions, and you can choose the time of each slide shows. So I just have this folder full of pictures of Rana Maharshi, about 500 of them, and sayings and stuff. So I just chose that as my screensaver. So now after 10 minutes, this screensaver comes on, and it's Rana Maharshi. So I just sit there in front of my computer not doing anything, and the screensaver will go on. And then I can just watch these slides of Rana Maharshi with his quotes, all his quotes. And just any time at all during the day, I'm constantly being reminded of his quotes. And I notice something, say, oh, yeah, that's a great one. Oh, yeah, wow, love that. It's a wonderful, wonderful help. Try that one. Make a screensaver. I have on my Flickr, I think I have my Flickr page, I have a lot of pictures of Rana Maharshi. I'm going to upload some more. So you can download, well, it takes a while though, doesn't it, to download all of those. I wish you could just download a whole folder. But like for me, I'm industrious enough, I'll download hundreds of pictures. It takes hours, yeah. But then you'll have it on your computer, a folder, where you can simply then choose as a screensaver all those quotes. It's super, super helpful. Great, great idea. Wonderful. You see, the Holy Spirit has given us these ideas now of how can we keep reminding ourselves of this uncontestability of the mind, and see it that way. The mind can't be contested at all. Nothing's happening in the mind as far as contestment. There's never anything other than just right now happening in the mind. That's it. That's all that's happening is just now, right now. And there's really no happening to that. It's all now. And so the mind is untouched. The mind is untouched. So the mind, looking at the mind as untouched, looking at that, that is this, the peace, great peace. How are we doing here? We're doing pretty good. We're getting close to the end of this video here. This is another classic one, doing the full 4 gigabytes. My body's tired. It's a good tired, though. Wow. Swinging that cough. Oh, my gosh. You know, really. But I feel like my body can handle it. You know, it's not all wiped out. It's sore, but it's not wiped out, which is really a good feeling, actually. So screensaver, think about a screensaver. You can download any of the pictures I have on Flickr, my Flickr site, and down in the description of the video it should be a link to the Flickr site. You can download any of those pictures. I'll try to keep making better and better ones. I want to make some of them onto my mom, but I'm having trouble because her quotes, she's not as quotable as Rana Maharshi. She had a different style, very different style, very difficult to, she was very elusive in her answers, very abstract. She can. It's very difficult to pin her down. She has some quotes, but it's, and her demeanor is different too. It's difficult. I just really have a very difficult time to do this. She is so distant. Yeah, Rana is a little more down to earth. You feel you can connect a little bit. Rana to my mom was so different, such an aloofness and distance that there. Everybody, even the closest devotees, experienced this. Like she really wasn't here at all. Or she was everywhere. There's no here. It's just everywhere. She was really like everywhere. Right now. Always everywhere. So there's never no sense of here-ness so much. She would be here, but she'd also realize that not really, she's everywhere. So, I don't know what to do about with the picture, her pictures there, to have, with quotes, you know, and helping people out. Ramana's great. Ramana's really great. That's why I've highlighted him. He lends himself to that. I don't know what Ananda Maya lends herself to exactly. It hasn't struck me yet. Maybe it will. You don't want to say, oh, she's beautiful. Oh, what a beautiful goddess. No. There's something else. There's some other quality that's hard to put into words, actually. I know what it is. I just don't know how to put it into words. Or I could put it into a picture or something. It doesn't quite come across in a picture so well. It comes out better in videos with her and onto my mind, but really better than in pictures. Because in pictures, it's just like her body's not even there. Her consciousness is not identifying in any way. She's not there, hardly, you know, really. It's just, it's very...